Hey guys, James here, and welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, this channel is all about sharing my lifelong love of cars with you guys. Today, we are sitting in the 2021 Lexus IS300, and I'm gonna take this for a spin. This is my first time driving the fourth generation Lexus IS. I was an owner of a 2010 IS350, that's the second generation, and I've driven a bunch of third generation and third generation refresh ISs, and so I'm really eager to find out what this car feels like. Has Lexus done enough to make the fourth generation IS worth actually considering? Let's take this thing on the road and find out. This car has the Turbo 4 that Lexus has been dropping into a bunch of their products, and in this particular vehicle, it puts out 241 horsepower and 258 pound-feet of torque. Now, you guys know from watching my channel that I'm not a numbers guy. I really don't care what these numbers are. So let's talk about how this engine feels. First off, in terms of responsiveness, this engine is very adequate. I personally think it responds just fine. It's not quite as athletic and eager as the inline four, the turbo four, in the G20 BMW 330i, which I just drove last weekend. But the more I drive this car, the more I enjoy the fact that the engine is, although it's not super eager and just ready to chomp at that bit, it's actually incredibly smooth and it gets up and goes. It does its job, it's very adequate, and that's the key thing. It's super smooth. But there is one kind of weird quirk about this car. When you step on that gas, you can actually really hear the turbo spooling up. I'm not talking about turbo noises like, you know, like I'm not talking about like Alfa Romeo 4C or like Subaru WRX STI kinds of noises. I'm talking about it's really weird because you hear the engine revving up and then you hear the turbo spooling up. It's like these two noises, one of which is very high pitched and kind of silly. And I'm gonna try to pick up some audio for you guys to hear it. Hopefully it'll come through. Well, let's talk more about that transmission. So this, again, is an 8-speed automatic transmission, torque converted, very traditional type of transmission. It's got paddle shifters and it's got like the shifter down here, manual shift modes. Compared with, say, the ZF 8-speed, that's kind of in everything these days, like the BMW 330i, which is one of the main competitors of this car. Well, this transmission is not nearly as athletic, responsive, eager. So right now I'm just cruising at 54 miles an hour on, it's sort of sloping upwards. I'm gonna put down my foot and let's see how long it takes for it to downshift. So 3, 2, 1, press. And now we go. So there is a big delay before it downshifts. The good news is that when it does downshift, when it finally does get to that lower gear, it doesn't second guess itself. It just goes there and then off you go. But it's quite slow to actually make that downshift. But that sort of suits the character of the car, right? When you look at this car, you might be fooled into thinking this is a real sporty sedan. But the more you drive it, the more you realize this is meant to be a luxury sedan. It happens to be compact, but it's actually quite luxurious and smooth at the end of the day. So the transmission, you know, the fact that it is slow at downshifting is less of an issue when you treat this car in the way that it's supposed to be treated. So overall, the powertrain in this car is a lot more relaxed than you might find in like a G20 330i. There's less power and torque, and it's less responsive, but it is a lot smoother. That car kind of had some weird transmission behavior, especially at low speeds. It kind of gave me a little bit of nausea driving around town with these semi-rough downshifts when I drove it last weekend. This car, butter smooth. Transmission shifts are sort of imperceptible unless you're paying attention. Oh, let's check out these wheels and brakes here. Well, we've got this car running on 18-inch rims with these pretty sweet looking wheels. Wow, what a design. And these brakes are unbranded. They're, you know, they're just Lexus brakes, but they work really well. They're super smooth and they're really responsive on the street. I have not tested these brakes on the track, so I don't know how they hold up on the track, but I doubt they would hold up very well. But on the street, I have to say they're really responsive and extremely smooth. So good stuff there, Lexus. One of the aspects of the new IS that Lexus really tried to emphasize in their marketing before this car's release was the fact that they like tuned the suspension and the chassis on like some racetrack or mountain road or something in Japan. This is a really interesting aspect of this car to discuss because the platform that this car is built on dates way back to 2005, and it actually showed up in the second generation IS in 2006, or for the 2006 model year. But here's the thing, even though this platform is more than 15 years old, it's still really, really good, and I think it's honestly the high point of this car. Where this car really shines is that balance of comfort and handling. It's really comfortable. I was surprised at how comfortable it is. Just over potholes, broken pavement, it just kind of sails through all of this, and on pretty low profile tires too. If Lexus set out to make a really comfortable compact sedan, this is it, man. This thing is super comfortable. Compared with the 330i, I think this car is way more comfortable and just a little bit less eager in the handling department. On a scale from -5 to +5, where let's say -5 is like massive understeer and +5 is like massive oversteer in the corners, I would put this car at about a -1.5. There is distinct push in the corners, and maybe the 3 Series, the G20 330i, would be something like a -1. Here's the crazy thing, it feels a lot smaller than the 330i. So in the corners, yes, there's a little more push, a little more understeeriness compared to the 3 Series, but it feels a lot smaller, and so the net result is that it's nearly as nimble, in my opinion, as the 3 Series. All right, we're taking a break from driving here to talk about this interior. First off, everything feels nice and luxurious. Everything's padded and soft and very solid feeling. I would argue that this feels a lot more solid than the BMWs these days that are a little more chintzy in the way that they feel. Everything here feels super solid. The second impression I get is that this interior is snug. I'm not saying that it's necessarily a bad thing. I'm actually a big believer in buying a car that's the right size for you. It's a bit like buying clothes, right? Or buying a suit, let's say. When you buy a car that's like a little too big, it feels like you're in a suit that's like off the rack and it's like two sizes too big. Versus a car that's the right size, it can feel really nice. So this interior, even though it feels kind of small and kind of snug, that could be a good thing if this is enough space for you and you're looking for more of that cockpit, kind of closed off, kind of cozy feel. The trunk space is also not very large and the opening is rather small. So you want to make sure that, you know, if you're going to have a lot of stuff, you're going to schlep around, if you love to leave a whole bunch of crap in your trunk, make sure that there's enough space in this trunk for you. I don't like to keep a whole lot of stuff in my car, so it works for me, but make sure it works for you if you are interested in the IS, because the interior space and the cargo space are a lot smaller than in, say, a G20 3 Series. Another thing that kind of surprised me was how high up this driver's seat is. I have the seat set to its lowest setting right now, and I'm not very tall. I'm only 5'7", but you know, I have a very good view of the road. My visibility is great. It's totally fine for me, but note that I have this at its lowest setting and I'm still pretty high up. If you are taller and you know, your head's like up here, this cockpit, this cabin could feel kind of weirdly like small, and it could feel like you're just kind of perched on top of it. So you're gonna want to sit in this thing and test it for yourself. So the high point of this cabin, I would say, is the materials, the quality. It just, everything feels so solid and padded and hushed. So now let's talk about the low points, and technology is really the low point of this interior space. The technology in this car feels unbelievably archaic, because you have this center screen that's a fine size. It's not super large. It's not that impressive, and you have this little screen in the middle of the gauges. And I know that this is not the F-Sport version. If you have like the F-Sport gauges, that's gonna change things up and make things a little bit more exciting. But in this base non-F-Sport version, you have just this little screen in here that's not very well integrated, because it's just this rectangle in the middle of two circles. They didn't even try to integrate it into the design. The problem with these screens is a couple of things. Number one, the pixels are way too big, right? Everything looks kind of grainy. Number two, the black levels are really not good, and they're different between the two screens. So at night, you can really tell that the screen inside the gauge cluster has a much higher black level. In other words, it's more gray when it's supposed to be black than the middle screen. So that's that mismatch doesn't feel good either. And third is the saturation of the colors is really weak on these screens. Reminds me a little bit about those like TomTom and Garmin screens. I'm talking like 2004. That's what these screens look like. They look like they're almost 20 years old, unfortunately. Luckily, Lexus has finally gotten onto the Android Auto and Apple CarPlay bandwagon. Thank goodness, because this infotainment is absolutely infuriating and it is horrible. This infotainment with the little touchpad thing, oh God, it's impossible to use even when you're standing still. Lots of people have complained about that. I won't go on about that anymore. Let's be grateful for the fact that Android Auto and Apple CarPlay are here. But of course, it's also not sunshine and roses, right? This is wired Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. And in this particular vehicle, it's broken. It doesn't work. The USB ports don't actually do anything. They don't provide power to my phone. They don't connect for CarPlay. I'm unable to report to you guys how well or how poorly CarPlay and Android Auto work. All I can say is that in this car, they don't work. But I don't want to end off the interior segment of this video on such a downer. I do want to say that the audio system in this car is really interesting and in a good way. The sound that comes out of these speakers is very processed, but in a very interesting way. It's not a bad thing. It gives me the feeling that I'm in a stadium or in a very large room. And I kind of like it. I quite like the spatial nature of this. I'm usually not a fan of digital processing of audio, but this one is one of the better ones. And so I'll take it. Let's get this thing going again and talk about who this car is meant for and, you know, who should buy it. I think the big lesson about this car is that looks can deceive. This car has a really sporty and high-tech look to it. It's got all these angles. It has kind of this futuristic look to the exterior. But what's funny is that this car is neither sporty nor high-tech. In fact, what it actually is just a compact entry-level luxury car that's extremely comfortable and very calming. So if that's what you're looking for, this is a great car. If you're looking for something more exciting, go for the BMW 330i or a Genesis G70. Those will be better options for you if excitement is what you're looking for. Thank you guys so much for sticking around until the end of this video. If you found it entertaining, informational, hit the like button down below. And if you're not yet subscribed, hit the subscribe button because I got a lot more coming out for you guys on this channel. Also, I'd love to hear from you guys. What are your thoughts on the fourth generation IS? Do you think that Lexus did enough to call this a fourth generation IS, or is it more of just like a superficial sort of aesthetic refresh? So let me know what your thoughts are. I'd love to hear from you. And I love learning from you guys too. Sometimes you guys will comment with some factoids that I didn't realize or I didn't know about. And that's always really great to hear from you. Again, my name is James. Thank you so much for joining me today, and I will see you in the next video.